Hello and welcome to the video. This is a video about this thing here. This is the new Hawkeye Firefly Film 2. Now, I looked at the Hawkeye Film 4K back in June 2023, and there are a number of things that I didn't like about it. The camera felt like a demo unit, not a finished product. I guess I was right, as they've just released the V2 and it hasn't been that long. Now, I've been looking for a camera in this form factor for a while, and I was excited when I saw this listed because it appears from the way that the logo is printed at the bottom that it can be used in upright position, and that means that I could potentially mount it in the top of fixed wings and planes and all kinds of different things with just the top poking out. So I thought I'd get one in to give it a try to see how it all worked. But unfortunately, it won't work in that vertical orientation. It'll only work in the horizontal orientation, and you can have it either way up, which is a bit of a shame because that was kind of one of the things I was hoping it would do. In terms of the top line features, this has a magnetic clasp at the back. It does support gyroflow, so it will save the gyro data onto the SD card along with the video footage. It does have a battery that they reckon will last you about 90 to 100 minutes, and it does seem to last quite a long time. It does have an AV out, so you could also get a live view via analog video. And then it has a Wi-Fi preview as well with an app that you have to put on your phone. And you will have to use the app if you want to change things like your settings too. Powered by 5 to 23 volts and is only 34.5 grams with that battery and a little SD card slotted in the bottom. So specifications for this is the Hawkeye 4K Film 2. The sensor in it is a Sony 12 megapixel unit. It's a 4:3 sensor from what I can see, so I'm not sure we're getting the full benefit of that in the 16:9 format that we'd normally use for video. Field of view is 170 degrees. Video resolutions go up from 4K 50 frames per second at the very high level. It does not save the gyroflow data, and then can go in either 16:9 or 4:3 layouts for 50 or 30 frames a second for both 2.5K, 1080p as well. Video format saving as an MP4, and that's H.265 encoding, so beware of that. You're going to need an updated codec if you're Windows 10 or 11. TV output, this is either PAL or NTSC. Latency is about 40 milliseconds. USB-C type port at the side for charging, and the SD card can be 8 to 256 gig U1 or above. Size is 53 by 23 by 22 millimeters, and as I said, weight is about 34.5 grams, and it'll pull about 550 milliamps when you're powering it from 5 volts. So with the camera on the front of the quad, it's a good opportunity to show you how to use the menus and things to change everything. So let's power it up by pressing and holding the power button. A couple of cheeps to let you know that it's active. We have a little green LED here at the front to show us that it's lit. And then if we double press the power button, it'll put it into Wi-Fi mode, which is that kind of flashing alternative green and red. On the phone, we need to find the Wi-Fi network. It's going to be called Hawkeye something, so we'll connect to that. We'll connect to it. Now the default password is 123456789, so we're now connected to that. Once that's set, you need to download this application called OK. I'm surprised it's not called something to do with the manufacturer, but I'm guessing it is. Once you've done that, you can just click on camera, and then we get a view out of the front of the camera. A little bit of lag on the Wi-Fi, but we have the options to set everything. So we can see the battery level, we can choose between a camera or video, we can change the actual settings. So let me show you these. Video resolutions are all the ones here. Everything from 4K, 50 frames a second, no gyro at 50 frames a second, sadly, and then everything all the other way down. I'll try it at a couple of resolutions and we'll see how it goes. At the moment, I've just set it for 1080p, 50 frames a second, just for the bits and pieces I'm doing here at the moment. Then we have cycle record, wide dynamic range is either on or off. Don't seem to be able to change those things, but we'll turn them on. Date stamping, time lapse, how the metering works, how the sharpness is, contrast, whether or not it's going to start recording as soon as you turn it on or off. Good idea. Quick recording mode. Gyro log is turned on. You're going to need that for gyro flow. Photo sizes, everything from 60 meg down to 5 meg. And then we have the exposure settings. Then we have things like auto power off after a minute, TV mode, NTSC or PAL, because it will do an AV out, 30 to 40 milliseconds latency though. Wi-Fi settings, we can change them in here if we want to. The frequency of 50 or 60 hertz, the TV mode that we want to output, I'm PAL. The TV ratio, 16:9, 4:3 or 4:3 full. And you can see here you have most of this stuff. But if we go back out of here, and there we are, we're back looking at the camera, then we can start and stop recording here at the bottom. And we have like a shortcut to all of the settings and to the gallery. To start and stop recording, we just, it's a single press on the button, we'll start and stop recording. So with that said, and it's now mounted on a quad, let's get some footage and have a look at it. So this is the recording from the onboard microphone. So I'm not going to do too much editing to this, so it might be a bit hissy. I'm not sure exactly how good the microphone in it is going to work. But as I walk up the lane here, it's an opportunity to stick it on the bridge and let's record in both 1080p, 2.7K and also 4K and zoom in to see if there's any differences in the resolution. Because if there is, then we know it's a proper 4K sensor, because too many of these smaller cameras, although they claim to be 4K, apologies for the air quotes, is actually an upscale 2.7 or something else. So let's try it on the bridge. So I've put the individual images side by side here on the screen. So in the top left hand corner we have 1080p, we have 2.5K in the top right hand corner, and at the bottom we have 4K. Now I haven't moved the camera, so it's an identical view down the field. All of these are 16:9 format, but what I've done is I have zoomed in to one of the four houses in the image to see how much additional detail there is. And as you can see, there isn't a massive amount of difference. The night and day that you tend to see on the high-end stuff from people like GoPro when you're shooting in 4K versus 1080p just simply isn't evident here. And that's a shame, because normally you see 1080p to 2.5K, there'd be quite a big bump. And then in cameras of this price point, you tend to find that the change in resolution from 2.5K to 4K, you don't get that much more information in the image. Here you can see they're all very similar. But using it in the air to fly around with, it actually works well. I'm recording stuff in 1080p because I can't see the point in creating much bigger files that don't have a lot more detail. There is a small amount of jello from the props. The colours are good, very natural and nicely balanced, but there is a decent amount of fisheye in this image. There's good exposure. Changing the exposure settings in the app could probably help with that. And an ND filter would definitely help in those brighter conditions to just manage everything. So in summary, there are lots of things that I like. I like the fact it has the onboard battery for those times when you don't have local DC power. I like the wide range of voltage inputs that it can run from, so you can run it direct from your onboard battery of whatever it is you're connecting it to. But you don't need to do that, because the onboard battery will last for about an hour and a half if you're recording at some of the lower settings. Wi-Fi access means changing the modes and settings is pretty simple, and the app is relatively easy to get hold of. You're just going to have to scan the QR code on the manual. The controls are super simple, long press to power on and off, single press to start stop recording, double press to turn on the Wi-Fi. Also that gyro flow support as well. I've had trouble with it here, and I guess that's the fact that it's H.265 recording. It would be nice if there'd been an option to record in H.264. The lens cover is removable, if a little fiddly, and I would have liked to see some ND filters in the kit rather than just this default one. But having a removable lens cover does mean if you scratch it or smash it, then you don't have to replace the whole thing. And there is an optional mount for a quad in the box. It can be controlled by Betaflight, as lots of these cameras can. And there is that AV out as well. But the latency is going to be 30 to 40 milliseconds. That's not going to be good enough for super fast flying, but probably usable for slower stuff with analog FPV. Gets a little bit warm in operation, but not warm enough that would cause me any concerns. There are, however, a number of things to be aware of. It only works when it's on its side. It doesn't work upright, despite what the logo seems to suggest, as it's printed on the bottom. H.265 recording, those MP4s may need an updated driver to play with, and no option to record in H.264 sadly. You do need the app in order to change the settings, but also to change the recording modes as well. There's no little screen on here to let you know what's going on. And it's maybe a little large for some things, but it's great for places where you need that battery, so be aware of that. The supplied mounts are a little odd. I've actually designed my own. I'll put a link in the description down to Thingiverse if you want to download it. So my final thoughts on this. The performance of this is good, but I definitely wouldn't call this a 4K camera. For this kind of cash, I'd want a couple of different mounts to put it on something like a quadcopter included in the box, and to have something like an ND8 or an ND16 lens in the box as well to make it more useful on those brighter days. It's a huge improvement on the original Hawkeye Thumb 4K that I looked at back in June 2023. This does actually feel like a finished product, and I need to give credit to Hawkeye for sorting that out. This is a nice update to the original camera that I looked at back in June 2023, but that was a pretty low bar. And it's not going to be beating things like the Runcam Thumb Pro 4K for an awful lot of pilots, myself included, unless you needed a camera with an inbuilt battery. If you have a little camera like this that works really well, that you really like, do let me know. I am on the lookout for something with an onboard battery that will record half decently at 4K. Thank you for watching my video. Check out the playlist, and adding Painless360 to your search terms will help you find my content. If you haven't done so already, please hit the like and subscribe button. It helps a lot. You can support the time I spend here answering questions and helping others by using the links in the video description.